Am I? Every day's intro is a little more Jewish to my heart. I mean, Murica. Logan, that was something.
Murica.
Wait. Logan, hit me. Science.
Did that work?
Okay, guys, so today I'm super excited because we're talking about one of my favorite subjects, anti-vaxxers. I actually hate it. As someone put in one of the comments, I posted this article earlier, they said, I'm going to avoid this podcast. You know why? Because anti-vaxxers make me stabby. And I didn't even know stabby was a thing.
As in stabby, like with a needle? You want to vaccinate?
Very
them?
Stabby. Exactly. So we're going to talk about this mumps outbreak that's been happening really throughout the country, but focusing on Arkansas, which I believe is the correct pronunciation. And we're going to...
No, it's not. It's Arkansas.
Don't correct Thank me, you. Tom Heineberg.
I'm from there, Z.
Arkansas.
So...
That explains almost everything. It explains almost everything. So we'll get back to that, but we're going to talk about... Do vaccines actually work? Okay, and because this outbreak is starting to lead people to think, could it be that these things aren't effective and we don't need them anymore? That's crazy talk. We're gonna talk about confirmation bias and other fallacies of the anti-vax movement and scientists as well. But first, it was interesting, this broadcast really was interrupted because I got a secret transmission from a battle station that I mistook for a small moon, and it was just simply entitled, Read Stat on the Air, quote, these are a few of my favorite things. Let's roll that.
Ceiling tiles, lawn mowers, bags of fertilizer, corn syrup, high fructose corn syrup, sugar packets, sweet and low, an entire coffee maker, Juan Valdez, all found in the rectum. A Keurig cold, a Keurig hot. Those little packets that you put in the Keurig. Taco Bell fire sauce. Once a whole case. Right in the rectum.
You know, that Vader clip reminds me of, mumps sound like a disease from a place long, long ago, far, far away.
Far, far, far away.
Honestly, as a muggle, I didn't even know that was a real thing anymore.
Well, I mean,
it sounds like it's from the 1900s. You got the mumps, see?
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, kid.
You know what? If you're not careful, if you don't buck up and take your castor oil, you might get the mumps. And then your balls will swell up, and you'll end up infertile, like your dad. Like, wait, that makes no logical sense. Pops, like, what? So that's how it used to be. And this is the thing. Diseases like mumps, measles, rubella, pertussis, they used to be big hits across the country, and now they're not. Do you know why? Logan, hit me. Science! Because of vaccines and the success of vaccines, that's why we don't have these things very much. Now, here is an article. Go ahead and put up the article clip, Logan. It's from Stat News. Mumps outbreaks are spiking and raising questions about vaccine effectiveness. All right.
Sounds like you were wrong the entire time, Z-Dog. And vaccines cause autism, and not only that, they don't even work.
Oh my God, Tom Heineberg. All this time I've been telling parents to poison their children with mercury, aluminum, normal saline, aborted fetal cells, chemtrails, goutagens that cause gout. Am I wrong, guys? Has Z-Dog MD been telling lies this whole time? Or could it be that once again, the media is effing with us? Let's unpack this article bit by bit, and let's go through it and let's talk about this, because I think the anti-vax crowd is taking this and going, see, we told you vaccines don't work and they're poisoning our children, which makes absolutely no sense. And pro-vaccine people are going, let's investigate this a little further. And each of them is approaching this article with their own confirmation bias. Confirmation bias is a logical fallacy where we try to take facts and we spin them through our own pre-existing prejudices, biases, hopes, dreams, fears. In other words, to use the parlance of Z-Dog Industries and Incident Report, our elephant, our unconscious, emotional, intuitive engine is making decisions, and then our little writer who sits on top and rationalizes them, our press secretary, our little Sean Spicer, then spins it in the way that makes our elephant comfortable. So,
Mini Spice. Love that guy.
Mini Spice. I like that. You know, Tom, stop shaking your head back there, okay? Stop shaking your head back there.
You know what? Do what I want. I do what I want, Z.
All right,
back to mumps.
Back to mumps. So let's read this, and we're going to say how different groups are spinning this and why the science matters. Okay, Springdale, Arkansas. Now, Tom Heineber, you are from, your dad actually used to...
Mark Heineber governed the paper there, aka he was their lawyer, which isn't governing at all. I grew up in Fort Smith, Arkansas, which is like northeast, that's northwest. But we used to go to Springdale often.
And it's close enough to Kansas to warrant a carry on my wayward son.
It's not that close, not close
enough.
Well,
it's our Kansas.
Well, not really.
Okay, never mind. So for a while, it seemed like mumps outbreaks engulfing the northwestern Arkansas city would never end. And they were seeing about 40 patients with mumps a day. And doing, listen to this, guys, medical people, swirling cotton swabs between the cheek and the jaw while massaging the salivary glands, they began calling themselves swab queens. That sounds like it needs its own restroom, don't you think?
What would that restroom be called, though?
It would be the Swab Queen. There'd be a little cartoon on there with a swab. So it's interesting. When I read this piece, I just realized I have no effing idea how to culture for mumps. And do you know why that is, Tom Heineber?
Why is it? Because you're not a real doctor?
No. It's maybe.
You're just a rap doctor?
It's because, Tom, we don't really need to do it anymore in the modern era, or haven't for a long time, because of the success and efficacy of vaccines.
I asked my wife what she thought about mumps, and she said, I've never seen it, so yeah. I don't know.
No, we have not seen it, right, since a long time ago. Now, the outbreak started in 2007. There was a big bump, and then now this is the second biggest outbreak we've had in a while. Multiple states. I think there are only 13 states that are reporting no mumps. And so what is going on? Why are we having to relearn how to deal with mumps? And here is more of the article. So last year marked the second highest annual case count of mumps in more than a quarter century. All but 13 states have reported mumps so far this year. The reason for the resurgence is a mystery, but officials fear that it could undermine the public's faith in immunizations, critical public health tools that are already under attack from people who believe vaccines are more dangerous than the diseases which they protect. And that line in the article has a link to an article titled, "Meeting with Trump Emboldens Anti-Vaccine Activists Who See an Ally in the Oval Office." So we're in a situation now where the anti-vaccine platform is being given increased credibility through political sources and just in general because we're seeing these mump outbreaks, and the way the anti-vaxxers are spinning it is, see, the vaccines don't work, because 92% of the patients who are having the outbreak, affected by the mumps outbreak in Arkansas, are vaccinated for mumps with two MMR vaccinations. So what the heck is going on? You guys are probably thinking, huh? Actually, the smart people already know some of the answers to this, because you guys are all about, Logan, hit me. Science! Here's a piece that we need to understand. What is mumps and why do we even care? So if there's a big outbreak in Arkansas, is it killing people? Is it causing problems? Well, mumps typically is caused by a virus. It causes parotid swelling, facial swelling, fevers, flu-like symptoms in mild versions. In more severe versions, it can cause orchitis, which is testicular swelling, which Tom Heineber has been trying to get for decades. And instead, shriveled little raisins.
It's a sign of culture, okay? I'm more evolved.
It really is. It really is. That's right. Pearl-sized testicles are a sign of highbrow white privilege.
Liz Moses wanted to know, how does one even assess for the mumps?
Right, so obviously the swab that we talked about, but looking at the clinical signs, so the swollen parotid glands, the fevers, the clinical history, and you always look for orchitis, signs of testicular swelling. Now, why does orchitis matter, even though it's a relatively rare complication? Because it can lead in cases to sterility. So in other words, a permanently sterile male who starts out, and you know, we're talking about kids 4 to 18, they're the ones having the biggest outbreak right now, ending up affecting their ability to procreate forever. So on a Darwinian level, this is horrible. On an emotional human level, this is potentially devastating. But the more devastating complication is meningitis, inflammation of the lining around the brain, and encephalitis, inflammation of the brain itself. That can be rare but deadly complications of mumps. So people who say these diseases are harmless are smoking that crack. Okay, this may be your mump day Wednesday, but you don't want it to be your mump life, because it can take your life. Not only that, but it can prevent you from creating another life. Now, in the setting of all this, what's interesting is in the Arkansas outbreak, northwestern Arkansas happens to be the location of the highest number of documented vaccine refusals in the state. Now, why would that correlate to a condition where vaccinated individuals are getting the disease? Those of us who understand science understand that there's something called herd immunity, or community immunity is the kinder, gentler term for those who don't want to be labeled sheep by anti-vaxxers. So community immunity says that when you vaccinate enough of a crowd, including the entire population, the reservoir in which the virus can actually replicate and spread is lessened because everybody has some at least low-level immunity. Now, when herd immunity fails is in cases like northwestern Arkansas, where you're not vaccinating the entire population. In conjunction with a vaccine that may not be perfectly effective, which we know the MMR, all vaccines aren't, right? But we know MMR, the mumps component of it, is actually the least effective component of the MMR vaccine. So a single shot is only 77% protective, and two shots are something like 88% protective, as opposed to the 90-some percent protective for measles, et cetera. So it's not a perfect shot. Now combine that with an area where there are unvaccinated spawn running around, potentially carrying and spreading mumps. Mumps has a tremendously long incubation period, 12 to 15, I think even longer than that, days, if I'm remembering correctly. And that means that you can carry it and spread it in saliva, it's spread through saliva, for that long without even knowing you have it. This is a huge problem. This is why the disease spreads, particularly in tighter knit communities. And it's interesting, one of the interesting pieces in the article that we can unpack is that this northwestern town of Springdale, Arkansas, has one of the highest populations of Marshall Island expatriates. So people from the Marshall Islands that used to be a former US protectorate, they can come to the US and work without visas. So there's a huge population there. It turns out culturally, this has kind of been looked at, they tend to live in multi-generational homes. They share drinks and food. It's a very warm and familial culture. And as a result, a perfect incubator vessel for spreading mumps. So let's combine this picture. Some unvaccinated spawn running around that create a reservoir or potential source for original infection. Vaccinated individuals who got both shots, like the 92% of people who were infected, and this crowd actually having a vaccine that may not be the perfect vaccine. It's not perfect, like any vaccine. So a higher rate of infection. Now, here's the twist. In this population that was studied, the rate of complications, or chitis, meningitis, etc., were really, really low compared to historic mumps outbreaks. What does this tell us? It tells us that most likely, either the new circulating strain of mumps, which is mumps strain G, in the old days it was A and another strain, the new strain is either less virulent, it causes less disease, or the vaccine is at least partially effective against mumps G. And as a result, being vaccinated protects you from the most deadly complication of the disease, meningitis and encephalitis, and the most damaging complication, which is sterility. So in many ways so far, what we're seeing is an advocation to, number one, make vaccines better, number two, keep fucking vaccinating. You have to keep vaccinating. Not vaccinating is probably the cause of this. Tom, thoughts?
None.
Comments?
Vaccinate your damn kids.
When Logan says something, it's always something crucially important. So here's another.
Well, Mark K. Jacob here says anti-vaxxers equal job security.
Anti-vaxxers equal job security. The problem is they're infecting our vaccinated children with mumps. And that is not. That's not job security.
Also, good God, even if you guys could get rid of every disease that can be taken care of with a vaccine, there's still so much for you to do as a healthcare provider.
Yeah, we got plenty of business, guys. We got plenty.
It's not like, you know, you're dependent on that.
I got one word. Hit me with some reverb. Diabetes! That's enough to keep us busy for life. So I want to unpack one more thing about this mumps epidemic. So we've got a part, the vaccine, okay, the MMR. Now the CDC is looking at this and they're kind of like, could it be this vaccine was designed for mumps A, right? Could it be that this mumps G, even though in laboratory tests it shows cross-reactivity and we should be immune to it, could it be that this vaccine isn't really perfectly designed for mumps G and we need to do some improvements on the vaccine to make it more effective? And this is a problem because vaccine development and implementation takes years and millions of dollars. And so this would be a huge drain on an already sort of stressed system. And people who think pharma makes billions of dollars off MMR is probably smoking crack, and certainly pediatricians don't. So this is a problem. We do need to study it to see whether we could do better with MMR, but the first thing we need to understand is we still need to give the MMR that we have.
Hey, I got a question for you, and you might not know, but what are the economics of MMR? The vaccine. Why do they make it? How does it make money if they don't make that much?
You know what? And I haven't dug into the deep dive on how the companies that make MMR make money. And I bet if you watch one of these quacky like conspiracy movies like Vaxxed, they'll say, oh, it's all about Scrooge McDuck diving into a pool of gold bullion. And
that's what I'm thinking. But yeah. I bet they make way more money on Viagra.
Dude, it is so much easier to make money on stuff that doesn't cause that degree of controversy than vaccines. Come on, guys. You're smoking crack. Pharma's evil, but they do some good. That is one of the good
well,
that they do.
They may be evil, but they're also smart.
Yeah, they're smart evil.
Right.
They're kind of scary smart evil, yeah. Which is a beautiful cocktail for destruction of everything we know and love, and also saving it at the same time. So the thing about this is, people who don't vaccinate in Arkansas are not allowed to go back to school if there's been an active case until like 26 days have passed, which means they're missing a tremendous amount of schools. So their parents are still refusing to vaccinate them, and they're missing school. And they're acting as a potential reservoir for disease. So come on, guys. And now anti-vaxxers will like to cherry pick. So we were talking about confirmation bias earlier.
Yeah.
So what the anti-vaxxers will do is this confirms their pre-existing bias in their mind. They take the data from this that confirms it. See, these vaccines don't even work. And the kids who are getting mumps, they're already vaccinated. So it can't be that the vaccines help and we should just not vaccinate because it's a bad idea. Whereas people who are pro-vax are like, see, what's happening here is the failure of universal vaccination, and we need to keep improving our vaccines, and we need to study why this mumps is still happening. And we're seeing an attenuated mumps virility, meaning or virulence, which means the mumps that we're getting is not as bad, right? So in many ways, obviously, I'm going to fall on that latter camp because can you hit me with some reverb? Science!
Science!
And I care about science, and I care about children, and I care about helping people because that's what we do in healthcare, right, Tom?
Kat Moore has an interesting comment. She says, Arkansas in here. I live an hour away from Northwest Arkansas now, but I lived in Northwest Arkansas for many years. Northwest Arkansas has a ton of naturalists, as well as a lot of wealthy soccer moms who are anti-vaxxers. And I also know that it has a tremendous poor population who do crystal meth. So why does this hit the highest and the lowest stratospheres of our society?
It's interesting how you only know the population of crystal meth doers, and you don't know the population of soccer moms and naturalists, which I think is a fascinating indictment of your white privilege.
Like, well, isn't like Santa Monica one of the most unvaccinated places in our country?
Santa Monica, Marin County. So typically this is a disease of affluenza, of hyper-educated, hyper-rich, not hyper-rich, but upper-middle-class people that feel like the rules don't apply to their children because they're exceptional. They feel like they're educated and they can outthink the doctors and the level of respect is gone. And they also don't trust. They tend to be a little more liberal-leading or libertarian-leading, and they don't trust government or industry to not try to harm them.
Dude, Joanna says anti-vaxxers should visit a cemetery from the 19th century and count the headstones.
They will run it through their confirmation bias filter, and they'll say the reason that those people died was bad sanitation. And if we just, you know, flushed our tampons down the right garbage instead of into the main system, then we wouldn't get tamponosis or whatever they think we have now. This is the problem with confirmation bias. When your ideology, when your elephant believes one thing, you will spin the data. Your press secretary, your conscious writer will spin it in any way.
Let's talk about this too. Why does the elephant believe fake facts?
Well, because it will try to believe their real facts because they support the intuition of the elephant, of this unconscious primitive processor that we evolved over millions of years.
Well, right? I have a theory that, you know, when we were, you know, young, small mammal creatures on the savannah, there were level one and level two threats. And if a level one threat presented like a level two threat, like let's say the wind was rustling through the stuff, and you treated it like it was a lion out there, right? You had a higher chance of survival than treating it like, well, it's probably just the wind. Everything will be okay.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think our elephant, and actually Jonathan Haidt talks about this in his book, The Righteous Mind and Happiness Hypothesis, that this is a threat detector. It's designed, the elephant is designed to respond to fear and threat in a way that it has a negative bias. So everything is evil until proven otherwise.
And the elephant has kept us alive.
It's kept us alive. Look at the anti-vax ideology. It's actually It's a pretty evolved and adaptive ideology. Oh my gosh, you're trying to like inject my child with toxins with a needle. That's unnatural. I mean, it's a very actually rational elephant response because it's fear-based.
Mumps right? is something that happened like in the 20s. So we don't even have it anymore. Why should I care?
My God, you sound like Ivanka Trump's health coach, dude.
Dude, oh my God. Have I not told you that I am Ivanka Trump's health coach?
Wow. By the way, why are you wearing your sunglasses in the house? Are you Corey Hart?
They're blind.
They're prescription fools.
Prescription sunglasses. Only Tom Heineberg would have prescription. You need to get like some transition lenses or something like, or you know, the ones that flip down like in the 80s.
Dude, Z, the thing about you is you're a vaccine shill who wants to toxinate my body. Okay, well, so why would I listen to you, man?
This is Incident Report 007, and I'm licensed to shill, Tom Heineberg, so that's what I do. I'm a vaccine shill. Right, so there's the elephant again telling the writer, hey, make an argument that proves my emotional point by spinning the facts a certain way, and that's why, again, the elephant believes alternative facts. And in this case, there are a lot of alternative facts, but if you read this article through the prism of actually having a lot of science experience, you're going to read it with what I believe is the right takeaway, which is we need to vaccinate our children, we need to continue to work on improving vaccines, and we need to take things like mumps and these previously preventable diseases very seriously, especially when they're resurgent. And things like pertussis are coming back, measles, we had an outbreak in Disneyland. This is legit, guys.
Does it drive you insane as a scientist to hear people call incomplete, small trial, unproven, non-peer-reviewed stuff science?
It hurts a lot. The problem is that's a lot of the science we have out there because doing a randomized controlled trial is expensive, it's hard. And the other crisis in science right now is replicability. We can't replicate trial results because it's expensive and hard to do. And so you may even have a randomized controlled trial that shows something, and if you try to replicate it, you can't. Well, that tells you, something's wrong.
Cynthia Ayers says, we haven't had a good plague in a long time, .. And there's something to that. She's saying that we need to appreciate what we have, right? And we need terrible circumstances to let us appreciate our cushy lives.
Well, you know, you just might get that wish if we keep on this path. Especially, you know, and again, my elephant responds very poorly to any politician who is a sort of anti-science on either side. Right, so there are very liberal politicians that are nervous about vaccines. There are conservative politicians that are nervous about vaccines. Everybody seems to be concerned about climate change. By the way, the climate change one is interesting because you can look at the science saying that the planet is heating up, but it's filtered through the elephant's ideology. So if you believe like private enterprise and government out of your face is a good thing, then you're going to say, well, it can't be us, because it's just an excuse for the government to try to clamp on a bunch of taxes and restrictions, right? So I think if you're talking to an elephant that has that ideology, you really have to think, is there a free market way you can manage climate change that helps the economy instead of hurts it?
It's a natural cycle, Z, okay? It's a natural cycle. Earth gets warm sometimes, bro. What, you want it to be cold forever? You a parka salesman?
Look, I saw Ice Age 1 and 2 in sequence because I have children. And I hated them both. So if an ice age ever came, I would be so out. I would be on the first Elon Musk rocket to Mars, and I would be pitching a tent on Mars with like 30% of the gravity. I'd be ripped, dude. I'd be like 50 pounds. It'd be incredible. Totally on that. Let's read some comments. Actually, swine flu a few years ago was worse than publicized, and if it wasn't for the timely release of vaccine, it could have been much, much worse. Susan Robinson. Susan, I'm on board with that assessment. Let's see. Okay, the word science has been used 345 times. I feel like a drinking game will come out of this show. Miguel Orozco.
For those of you that are drinking at home.
Science! isn't Mars cold AF, Donna Gardner? You know, in fact, it's cold as hell. Not cold AF, Donna. Cold as hell. Cold AH. So let's see here, what do we got? So this mumps strain is the beginning of a zombie virus, Lori Wilcox. Oh God, Lord, duh, of course it is. I mean, this is the beginning of the mumps apocalypse. It's just a matter of time. By the way, Tupac isn't dead, you know that, right?
Dude, Tupac is living Life! Actually, he got taken down by a vaccine. People don't want to tell that part of the story. Yeah. But it was true. It was real. They drove up, and they just chucked vaccine needles at
they
him.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. They did a drive-by syringe attack. Actually, when I was at Stanford, I had this running joke, because there was this running conflict between Stanford Hospital and the VA, and they were both under the auspices of Stanford University, but they used to have this ongoing gang war. So I had this whole routine where I had the VA gang sign. I think it was like this. VA! And we would drive by Stanford when I was on rotation at the VA, and we would do drive-by syringe attacks where we would just be like out the hood, and then just, and then when the person died of the syringe, the coroner would be like, you know, and they're like, oh, what is this? It's like a fatal mixture of sisapride and erythromycin, because we would do crazy shit like that. We would have interactions that were pretty much undetectable except by, you know, coroners, that would cause fatal arrhythmias, because that's how we rolled. And also, hit me with some reverb. Nerds!
All right, it's too much. You guys are beating that reverb joke into the ground. Chris Dixon says, why don't we make it a legal obligation to vaccinate kids? Why don't we make it a legal obligation, Z?
Because this is Murica. Didn't you see our intro? There's an eagle flying and an apostrophe, Murica. Because people won't be told what to do by the government. Pretty much anywhere, but especially in this country. So I think there is a balance between individual liberty and the collective good. In this case, I think there should be repercussions if you don't get vaccinated, but you can't really force somebody to do something, right? Because that's, you know.
Well, couldn't you not allow their kid to attend a public school?
Yeah, you cannot allow their kid to. I mean, I'm for draconian measures. Like, I think if you as a parent don't want to vaccinate your child, then you want to homeschool your child, or you want to put them in a private Arkham Asylum leper colony homeschool thing on Molokai, where they learn, you know, that the moon landing was fake and that chemtrails are like full of, you know, toxins. So if you want to do that, I'm all for you doing that. Listen, guys, I'm a militant pro-vaxxer. However, the minute you show me a randomized controlled trial that vaccines actually cause autism and don't prevent disease, I will be the first in line to eat the humble pie.
And y'all want to know why that is? Go ahead and hit him with the verb.
Science! let's see. Any other good comments on this one?
Melissa says, thank you, school nurse here.
Yeah, school nurses. So, you know, I talked to a school nurse here in Las Vegas. I won't name the school. It was a private school here. And she's like, all our parents are rich. All our parents are entitled. Most of these kids aren't, you know, they don't want vaccinations. And the parents have all these reasons for why. And yet, they will come to my office. She had a kid come to their office complaining of a bellyache. And she said, what do you think? Was it something you ate? And the kid goes, it wasn't something I ate. It was something I didn't eat. It was because I didn't have the grass-fed beef that I normally have. I had regular beef last night. This was a true story.
Ew.
We are building an army of douchebags.
Someone ruined that child, man. That's not their fault.
The child has been ruined by forces beyond his or her control.
Can I tell you a story?
Yes.
My mother-in-law runs a preschool, and there was this little kid, and he just cried all day for his mom. I went back 2 weeks later, same kid was still in the corner crying.
Wow.
I was like, what kind of children are we raising?
Yeah. You know, that kid may have had some other issues, but I'm telling you,
he
like...
He may have, but you can hear normal otherwise.
You can hear the sound of the helicopter blades overhead, and you the mommy copter with, you know, mama and dada in there. And, you know, I gotta admit, sometimes I'm guilty of this. I definitely, like, when we're at, like, the playground, when we were in Napa, I sent the kids to the playground, and they were, like, doing stuff, and I was like, I mean, when we were kids, man, I was hanging upside down by a toe over nothing. It was concrete. Explains many problems with traumatic brain injury that I've suffered over the years. But, man, I mean, I walked it off, and now look, I'm a third-rate internet celebrity. What are you, sheltered kid? Your grass-fed steak?
Dude, we're now living in a society where if you smoke in front of your child, you're considered a worse dad than dads that abandon their family.
Right, because abandonment at least is neutral. It's like, right. Well, you know.
It's so stupid. It's the stupidest thing.
Like, I mean, I don't know what's going on, Tom. Now, you both are millennials,
yeah.
Right? I don't think you were raised in hyper, you know, hyper helicopter families, were you?
No, you know what? And I think I blame the internet because, like, up until even like 2000, the internet was not that big a thing. People weren't getting their news from the internet or anything. So now it's like the world's atrocities are flooding into your screen every day, and you just, you know, you feel like there's more danger out there than there actually is.
Right. And there's been some thought about this because, in addition, there was a series of high profile kidnappings in the 70s that then people started going, oh, maybe I should keep my kid inside. And the actual statistics are society's getting safer, there's less violent crime, all these things. But we don't feel that viscerally because our elephants are like, damn, homie. In high school, you could just chill out like the man, homie.
Me and a buddy got lost in the woods in Arkansas when I was a kid.
This sounds like a Blair Witch, like meets Deliverance.
And we were lost literally all day. And then we found a fence and fought our way out and got out of the woods, etc. But when we got home, my mom was just like, clean up for dinner, it's dinner time.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, where have you been all day?
Totally. Now there would have been helicopter police searches, there would have been dogs. There would have been like, you would have been on a milk carton before you even got near that fence.
Seriously.
Yeah, it would have been Tom Heiner was like, little chubby face with a pacifier in it. Like, have you seen him? You know what I mean?
Well, and oh man, it just feels like all this anti-vax behavior is going to get worse in 20 years.
Wow, wow. I mean, you know it is, right? Because we're entering an idiocracy here in terms of science education and denial. I think part of the problem is like what we talked about yesterday when we talked about reading article headlines for scientific papers and things like that. Our level of science education and sophistication in this country has atrophied over the years, if anything. And nowadays, because we have all this access to easy information through the internet, all viewpoints are considered equal. An anti-vax, a vax, and people don't have the tools to critically think or to go through the data and the trials. And that's why we have experts to help us do that. Now, if there's conflicts of interest, you need to call them out. But I'm going to tell you, a pediatrician really doesn't have a conflict of interest. Their conflict of interest is they don't want to see sick and dying children, all right? The money they make from vaccines, a lot of times they lose money on vaccines, and if they make money, it's very, very small. Not enough to justify poisoning children if they thought that was what was going on.
So this goes into like science education, right? Because we always say down with the hierarchy, more with the holacracy. How do we get there? How do you teach people to think critically so they know what's more whole, what's more true?
Yeah, so I mean, you brought up, I'm going to unpack a couple things you said because for people who don't listen to the show regularly, when you talk about the term holarchy, so there's a hierarchy where you have like somebody dominating people underneath, something that's right and everything else is wrong, right? But when you talk about a holarchy, you're talking about something that is a little more right and includes the stuff within it. So how do we teach people that there are truths and there are bigger truths that enfold the other truths? And everything is kind of true but partial, but some things are a little more true and a little less partial. And when we're teaching science, that's part of how you teach it. You go, you know what? There's a lot of like subtlety to it, but this is where we are in terms of our holarchical understanding of stuff. And if we can start to, and I think even when we think politically, both sides are right, right? And there's some aspects that may be a little more right, like, well, maybe the earth is heating up and this is a problem, and if you don't know why it is, we can all agree that we need to do something about it, right? So that may be a little more true than not.
Donna Gardner says you can't instill critical thinking. That's like trying to give someone common sense. And I would argue that you can instill critical thinking.
Yeah, I think you can teach it. I think certain people are gifted with it, but I think you can definitely teach it because it's a way of thinking. Just like when you play an instrument, when you're practicing your scales, it's a muscle memory, a way of pattern recognition. It's the same with critical thinking. Now, some people are going to be much better at it, but being able to evaluate a scientific literature is something that can be taught. It's taught to us in medical school to different degrees, right? So it is an important skill set. The problem is children are seeing the public rewarding being uneducated. Well,
oh man, you know, I watched the Kardashians yesterday.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. They're the most rewarded for being uneducated.
Dude, her Instagram has something like 99 million followers.
Dude, this was a conversation on the show yesterday. They're staring at her phone. I don't like crepes. You don't like crepes? Nah. You don't like crepes. They have a weird consistency. Like what? Like a dead body. I don't like crepes. That's the show. That's what they talk about on the show.
That's the most compelling thing I've ever heard in my life, Tom Heinemann. I mean, how is that any different than what we're doing here? We're talking about crepes. Like, we're meta. We're one stage abstracted from the crepe discussion, talking about the Kardashians. But again, Brandy's comment
was spot on. Especially in Las Vegas, you're rewarded for not finishing school because you can get a job in a casino and get $80,000 a year between tips and salary. And so, of course, we have one of the lower college graduation rates, dropout rates, et cetera. It's all incentives and human behavior, right?
Good science is true whether you believe in it or not. Paraphrase from Neil deGrasse Tyson. By the way, We're number 9 on the iTunes podcast Science and Medicine charts. Neil deGrasse Tyson is number 2. We're coming at you, bro. Sup, Neil? Go to Zoo.
I ain't afraid of no deGrasse Tyson. Okay? you know, just because you're all smart, you think you're Sagan's, like, you know, successor, you think I'm scared of you, Neil deGrasse Tyson?
Dude, by the way, how awesome. You guys are so awesome for going and, like, rating it and leaving reviews, man. And it's helping us climb the charts and give the Z-Pack legitimacy. And it's so. Dude, I'm so. I was, like, up last night looking at the charts, just, like, so pumped about it.
I got a text from him at, like, midnight. And it was a screen cap from iTunes' top 10 science and medicine podcast, and we were number 9. And you could hear his girly screams from like a mile away. Just, oh my God! And then you know what I did? I called him up midnight, and I was like, I really don't like crepes because they have the consistency of a dead body.
You know, there's nothing wrong with screaming like a girl.
Nope.
You patriarchal dick.
You know what? I'm a holyarchal. It's a holarchy.
You holyarchal dick. Dude, so if you guys want to go on iTunes and rate and review, or just do it from a friend's iTunes account. It doesn't even have to be your iTunes account. If you already wrote a review, just go write another one for a friend. Like, we're cool with that.
Don't do that. See, this is the thing. This is the difference between me and Tom. Tom likes to cheat. I actually like to do it legit. But either way, we love you guys, Z-Pack. So on that note, I want to admonish you guys to go and read the articles on the mumps epidemics. Do your own critical thinking. And it's a trope of the anti-vaccine movement. Do my own research. I did my own research by listening to Kim Kardashian, and she said crepes were so grody. Don't do that kind of research. Use some critical thinking. And then hit us up in the comments. Share this podcast. Catch us on YouTube, where we post it in 4K, on my blog at zdogmd.com/incident-report. And please check us out on iTunes. We are so grateful to have you with us, Z-Pack. And we out.
Am I? Uh-huh.